Hello, everybody. Yenga Olatunji here, welcoming you to Jijin's Associate Channel. Corporate Strategic Management and Ethics here, CSME. And today we want to be looking at ethics, governance, and social responsibility of any business entity. Ethics, how does or how can we relate ethics to governance, and how relevant is ethics and governance to social responsibility of any business organization? That is what we are going to be looking at primarily here today. And at the end of this video, you should be able to understand and be able to answer questions as it relates to relevance and relationship between ethics, governance, and social responsibility. You should be able to answer as it relates to shareholders theory, stakeholders theory, social contract. Also, we'll be looking at the end of the day, you should be able to understand and know the first stances that an organization can take in governance. So we shall look at Johnson's and School's four stances. Then we will look at one of them that is a bit primarily prominent, Shapers of Society. So what stance is that? Shaper of Society will be looked at. Then also look at the seven classification, or what we can call position an organization can take on social responsibility. So seven classification of social responsibility, or seven positions of any organization in which any organization can take on social responsibility will be looked at, which Gray, Owen, and Adams propounded. So under the seven classification, we are going to be looking at the pristine capitalist. Who are they, and what classification is that? We are going to look at the expedient, we are going to look at social contracts, we are going to look at social ecologists, we are going to look at the socialists, that is socialist view, we are going to look at radical feminists, we are going to look at the last but not least, deep ecologists, or what we can call deep green view to corporate governance. So if you are just joining us and new on this channel, you are welcome, and we'll love that you subscribe to the channel so that you continue to receive timely notification as new videos are released. I promise to do that more often and be part of the family on Jijin's Associate. We are everything about accountancy, about management, about governance, it's been dished out. So subscribe right away. So let us go into ethics, governance, and social responsibility. First of all, by way of introduction, let us look at the relationship. Do we have any relationship that subsists or exists between ethics, governance, and social responsibility? Ethics, we've been talking about it for a while. So it simply means a moral view or world view of, it could be personal ethics, that is of an individual or corporate organization, who we call corporate governance ethics. So ethics simply means a moral view and opinion in which a person or an organization is being administered based on. So this worldview actually will make an organization different and unique in its mode of operations and business endeavor and pursuit. And when we are talking about governance, we are talking about the way in which a business is being run. That is governance. And please don't mix it up with management. We've dealt with all these aspects of corporate governance, management, ethics, and the like. You can look at some of our previous video on the playlist. So that is governance, simply put, the way in which the organization is being run. Then we are talking about social responsibility. Simply put, an organization is made up of people and located within an environment. And because an organization is an organism too in itself, it must relate and must be responsible for certain things. So therefore, social responsibility comes in. That is the way the organization relates with the outside world and the ecosystem around it. So how do they relate? Basically, ethics, governance, and social responsibility are actually interwoven, because the consequence of the moral or morality of an organization, or the founders of an organization, we dictate to a greater extent how the organization is going to be run. Don't forget, that's simple and layman definition of governance. So basically, ethics is the foundation of the governing style of an organization. And the way the organization is governed will directly or indirectly impact the society at large, in which then we'll be talking about social responsibility. So basically, you could see that they are actually really interwoven, and we cannot take one away from the other. Basically, the business entity operates within the society and interacts with local community, like employee, customer, and the like, supplier. So there's a link between ethics, definitely, corporate governance, and social responsibility, which I've explained. I just ran through our notes. So now, said we are going to be looking at shareholders theory, stakeholders theory, social contract. Let us pick them one after the other. So this is one of the world view an organization can take, that is shareholders theory. And when we're talking about shareholders theory, basically is telling us that the organization believes that its existence is actually to maximize shareholders' wealth. So this takes teleological approach actually to ethics. That is the theory of duty. I believe that is the duty of the organization to ensure maximum utilization of resources to generate more wealth for the shareholders and the founders. So that is what shareholders theory is about. And because the investors, that is, let's say people that buy shares in the organization or own shares in the organization, like the founders, the directors, and general public, some of the investors in the company, we invest for long run, and some we invest for short run and the like. The long-term shareholders most likely will want to support the view that the company should invest for long-term growth, for long-term successes and the like, and if necessary, short-term profits also too, in form of accruing dividend to them and retention of profit for the business so that it can be plowed back. And in the short term, shareholders will support that they should be paid high dividend. So these are benefits that accrue to shareholder under shareholders theory. So basically it's about maximizing their wealth for them. Then we'll talk about stakeholders theory, and basically we must not mix up the two together, because when we are talking about stakeholder, we are talking about the generality of the society as against the shareholders, that is people that have own share within the organization, that is they have a part in the organization when it comes to co-ownership. But we are talking about stakeholders, and stakeholders does not necessarily, or do not rather necessarily, have to be shareholders. They may not. So when we are talking about stakeholders now, it encompasses the employee, the possibly the employer too, the taxman or the government rather, the supplier, the vendors and the like, and any other person in which the existence of that organization may impact, either positively or negatively. They are the stakeholders. So when we are now talking about the stakeholders theory now, basically it takes another dimension or view to the existence of the organization, and basically summarizing it, we can say that this worldview or this theory believes that the organization should ensure that its positive impact is felt among the generality of the society, not only shareholders, maybe in form of dividend or maximization of their wealth. So stakeholders theory actually wants more from the organization to accrue to the general public, maybe to the employee, to the customer and the like, rather than concentrating its energy to ensure that it favors the shareholders. So the social contracts, when we're talking about social contract now, here the theory believes that the organization is permitted by the general public, and because the organization is permitted to exist by the general public, the organization has a duty to the general public and to have positive impact on the general public. So it's a social contract. So this based on the view that members of society give legal recognition to a company. And so we can say that if an organization, if the member of the society does not want an organization to be around them, most likely it may find it difficult to exist there, which we can agree, which we've seen that's happened all over the world. It's possible for people to around a community to resist the existence of an organization within their community. So, and therefore, if the organization existed, then it has been permitted and allowed and welcomed by the general public, and therefore it has a social contract with or to the community and to the general population for positive impact. So the company therefore has an obligation to pursue the objective of money making profits only in a way that will also enhance the material well-being of the society as a whole. I hope this is clear enough. So profit making must be ethical, and a company must consider the interests of the society in decision making and action that it takes. So basically, this is what social contract is telling us. So we move on now to the first stances in which an organization can take when it comes to its existence, its worldview, and the like. The first stances. So when we're talking about stances, what do we mean? Stances simply means that what we believe strongly and we are ready to stand for. What we believe in strongly as an organization or as individual, and we are ready actually to be counted for. That is our stance. That is what we stand for. That is a stance. So in 2002, Johnson and School actually suggested that basically four ethical stances are ways in which, or we have four stances in which we can categorize an organization or organizations into. If they are not shapers of the society, they are going to be pursuing the maximization of short-term shareholders' interest, and that is the least of ethical stance, maximizing the short-term shareholders' interest. And of course, the one I started with, being a shaper of society, is most heretical among the four stances. Also, if they are not shapers of the society and they are not maximizing the short-term shareholders' interest, then the third one will be that they are maximizing the long-term shareholders' interest. They are maximizing the long-term shareholders' interest. And if they are not, then they must be multiplying stakeholders' profitability or impact, positive impact. So they must be obliged and be responsible of having a stance or a view to stakeholders in which they recognize their obligation to the stakeholders group, some of them that we have mentioned, including the employees, the vendors, the suppliers, the creditors, payment of their taxes, and the like. So basically, an organization can be viewed and stand for these four stances. If they are not maximizing the short-term interests of the organization, especially the shareholders, they must be maximizing the long-term shareholders' interest. If not, they are pursuing and they recognize their obligation to impact positively general stakeholders or stakeholders group. And last but not the least, they position themselves to be shapers of society. So we move on to the subtopic, the shapers of the society. So when an organization takes a stand or have a stance as shaper of society, what does that mean and what does it entail? So shaping society means changing the condition in the society, that is making our environment better than we earlier met it as corporate organization. Even as individual, this can be applied, and altering the way the society operates and perceives us as organization. So, simply put, it means having a positive impact in the society. So, it could be in so many forms. It could, like, let's take for example, apple. Apple has radically changed our society, or generally the IT, information technology, talking about Apple, talking about Microsoft, talking about them, and for any reason we are not having any alliances with this organization, we are just using them because it's basically what we need to discuss. So having a greater influence, positive influence on organization, even looking at the medium in which we are currently using now, YouTube, has changed and influenced our environment all over the world. So that is how to shape and be shaper of society. The media has come to stay and it has metamorphosed, and it has positive impacts, whether now or in the nearest future, on the general population of human in the heads. So that is being shaper or shapers of society. So Johnson and schools, they argue that ethical companies recognize this role that they have, and their decision and actions are taken with a view to creating benefits for society and improving the well-being of the society. It has made our life better. Like, you are listening to me now, is at your home time, flexible for you to listen to lectures and the like. Media has made it happen. YouTube has made it happen. Facebook has made it happen. And any organization can make it happen too. Your organization can make it happen in the nearest future to be shaper of society. Ethics can be personal. We can have personal stances too, just as we can have corporate stances. We can have personal stances and corporate stances. So far that we know the meaning now of what a stance is, that is what we actually stand for, what we stand to be counted for, what we stand out for. It simply means our stance. So we can have personal stance. For example, a company might take a view that it will not do business with certain type of customer or supplier. That is a stance. Even individual can develop a conscious ethical stance on certain issues. Their decision and their action are affected by that particular stance that they've taken. So we can have personal and ethical stance. So now we move on to the seven positions or classification of social responsibility. The seven classifications of social responsibility, in which we'll be talking about pristine capitalists, expedient social contracts, social ecologists, the socialists, radical feminists, last but not the least, the deep ecologists, or people that believe in the deep greens. Okay. So the responsibility of society and to the environment. The responsibility to the society and to the environment by corporate organizations. So traditionally, moral philosophy has been divided into deontology and teleology worldview, which we've explained, that is consequential and non-consequential worldview. And believe you me, organization, business performance, business activity has consequence on the environment. It may be positive, it may be negative, but you and I will agree that organization has impact in the society, and because of that impact, they must take responsibility for what they've caused around us. So in 1996, Gray, Owen and Adams had the framework and look at the organization's impacts on the society in which they are located and are having their business endeavor, and concluded that we can classify their impacts and their worldview, their ethical stances, into 7 impactful worldview, and we are going to take them one after the other. First and foremost, looking at Christian capitalist, just from the word capitalist. So when we are talking about capitalist, we are talking about a person that had or has a worldview of having gain, utilizing his or our wealth to have more wealth. So this position is basically dominant in the world of accounting and finance, but not necessarily only us or in our industry alone. So the whole responsibility a company has is to make money for its shareholder and to maximize shareholders' wealth. So basically, that is capitalist worldview. That is capitalist worldview, is to make as much gain as possible, and it could be allowed and permitted by the general public. So shareholders have invested the risk capital, they've risked their labor, they've risked their wealth, and they have legal ownership of their organization, and they do business, and they are in need all to make profit and profit alone. So when that happens, we say that is pristine capitalist view. So it's based on self-interest rationale and putting individual self-interest before collective benefits of the society as a whole. Then we'll talk about the expedience from the world. When we say something is expedient, something is lawful, something is deemed. So individuals who have an expedient view also believe that the main aim of a company is to maximize wealth for its shareholders, and also that they should be responsible also for the society. So however, some concessions have to be made at the time for other stakeholders in order to put the company in a stronger position. And this is not too far away from pristine capitalist, because even though the expedient believe that it's lawful for them to maximize shareholders' wealth primarily, And also, if they want to maximize their wealth for a longer period of time, they need to contribute to the society strategically. And that word strategically is actually positional. It's meaningful, because at the heart of strategy is how to win and stay in the industry for long and win over competition. So therefore, there's an element of self-interest still in Expedient. They want the organization to run for as much as possible period, foreseeable future time, and that is why they are doing what they are doing and contributing to the world and the society around them. So sometimes Expedient can protect the environment, may support charity and the like to create a reputation for themselves and customer loyalty. That is Expedient worldview. Then let us move on to the social contract. So companies therefore here have a responsibility and obligation to respond to the need of society. So here the organizations see themselves as being responsible for the environment around them, and they take a strong position to do something about their impacts. Like usually we say footprint, that is negative impact that they've caused in the community, maybe because of their big lorries, they've damaged the road, and the road constructed could not last for long the way it ordinarily should have lasted, because their lorries are heavier than possibly the car weight that they actually made the road for. So maybe they reconstructed the road. That is having a social contract. That is, they know that they have a footprint within the community, and they try to correct their negative impacts around the location that they are domiciled. So that is social contract, that is having a view that they should be responsible to the society and make something better. So it's a right-based perspective in which the rights of all human beings are considered significantly, like the example I mentioned. They damage the road and they repair it or reconstructed it because they know that other humans around them will be affected if they leave the road in bad position. Just citing an example. So then we can talk about social ecologists. And when we are talking about social ecologists, just from the word ecology or ecosystem, the world around us, the individuals or the organization, corporate organization taking this position are considered or consigned for social environments. And when we are talking about social ecologists, their high concentration is about the human life. Please don't forget that it's about the human life. So they believe that the companies and other large organizations have been responsible for creating social and environmental problems, and therefore they should be held responsible for dealing with those problems and finding solutions to them. So that is social ecologist. They believe that the world around us, as we continue in business, when negatively impacted, we should try as much as possible rectify it and make it better, and if possible restore it to the original position we met them. Even though this may be highly impossible, but at least we can restore to a greater extent. And social ecology is a bigger phenomenon around us, and it's a big topic later that we are going to look at under governance and social issues as a topic on its own. Then when we are talking about socialist, that is the next classification, socialist is about human life. These individuals or the organization, they have a view that there should be a significant readjustment in the ownership of the organization and the structure of the society. So they criticize all forms of domination, including governmental domination, including individual domination, including corporate domination, monopoly, and the like. So they are not capitalists, they are socialists. They take up a worldview that this world belongs to all of us, and power or economic power should not concentrate on an individual or on a corporate organization. If not, that would be autocracy. Last but not the least, the radical feminists and the deep ecologists will be looked at. So radical feminist basically talks about women being subjugated, and basically radical feminists talk about involvement of the female folks and emancipation of the female, giving more opportunity to the female within the corporate organization. Deep ecologists or the green is an ethical decision that is based on all forms of life. All forms of life. So the deep ecologists believe that corporate organizations do not have greater life than the life of the living in the ecosystem, and that we should not destroy our ecology or the ecosystem for the sake of wanting to build a business. So deep ecologists have a deep opinion when it comes to our ecosystem and how organizations are being run, or how organizations should be run. So we had looked at the relationship between ethics, governance, and social responsibilities of organizations. We had looked at shareholders' theory, stakeholders' theory, social contracts, first stances. Now I want to believe we should be able to mention it, because when we started, you said this is one of the things at the end of the day we should be able to do. Going through this video, you should be able to answer the first stances that an organization should have. Are you mentioning it right away? Okay, minimizing, long time. Being shapers of the society and also recognizing the responsibility to the society at large. So minimizing or taking a worldview that we can minimize or maximizing for the short term profitability and wealth creation of the organization. That is what I mean by minimizing. Two, maximizing the long-term wealth creation, being shaper of the environment and even the industry, and last but not the least, taking a worldview that we should affect the general stakeholders. We had equally looked at what shapers of society means and the seven classification as given by Gray Owen and Adams. Looking at Christian capitalists, we had looked at the experience worldview, we had taken a look at social contracts, we had taken a look at social ecologist view, the socialist view, the radical feminist view, and the deep ecologists or the deep greens view. If you are yet to subscribe, please right away go and subscribe. Click the notification button. If you have any questions, please ask the question on the comment below, and you can be sure we are going to respond. From GJ's Associates channel, Gwinga Latinji will be signing off. Soon, we'll need to take another topic on corporate strategic management and ethics and any other course as it relates to accountancy.